Happy to take questions. Yes, Dave.
I actually have one for President Harmon if he could address my question. Mr. President, a few days ago, the House sent you a bill. It's not that bill. You were unambiguous that you didn't like it. It was a pile of, well, you didn't like it. And now this week, you bring out this bill that is pretty much the same as the bill you said you didn't like earlier. What happened?
Well, I like the bill very much. My job was to pass it through the Senate, and that's a process. And I'm very pleased that we all came together around our shared values and passed what I think is the strongest assault weapons ban in the country.
But I thought you disliked the last bill, one last
week. I did not dislike the bill. My job is to try to pass that through the Senate. And I needed the partnership of the Speaker and the Governor to make that happen, and we got it done.
Governor, you might have seen some of
Well, you don't get to choose which laws you comply with in the state of Illinois, let's be clear. The fact is that, yes, there are of course people who are trying to politically grandstand, who want to make a name for themselves by claiming that they will not comply. But the reality is that the state police is responsible for enforcement, as are all law enforcement all across the state. And they will, in fact, do their job, or they won't be in their job. Let me just get Tina, and I'll get you. Yeah. You know, getting something complicated and major done often requires some compromise and working with people. It's never perfect what comes out of a legislative process. I think all of the folks in the legislature behind me would say that. But this is one of truly the strongest and best assault weapons bans in the entire country. And so the result, I think, shows that there was a willingness to compromise, but also a determination to get something major done. Sorry, let me get one over here and I'll catch you, I promise.
Thank you, Governor. First, congratulations.
Thank you.
Next, Speaker Harmon on the Senate floor said, and I quote, "We'll see you in court." What are your words to your opposition?
Well, I think that, frankly, that the Senate President was simply acknowledging what all of the Republicans seem to have been saying, and certainly the NRA and the other groups that were opposed to this, that they're going to try to take this to court. So, you know, my reaction, of course, is this is a constitutional bill. The law here that we now have enacted is constitutional. There was a lot of thought that went into it to make sure that it would be. And obviously, things will go through the courts and they'll make their determinations, but I feel very confident. Yep.
Thank you so much. Could you go back to the enforcement component? Will there be a direct issue to the state police, to sheriff's offices, sheriff's association is supposedly pushing against this legislation? So can you explain further what you are going to do to make sure that registration occurs? Is it door to door?
Well, remember that anybody who doesn't comply, there are consequences for that. So, you know, we've given people, I think, a year, we're about a year, right, for people to comply, to fill out the paperwork and so on, and we expect them to do that.
Manufacturers can still make and sell ship guns out of state. What about the retailers who have inventory in their stores now? The sale and transfer is immediately illegal.
They are actually, there's a provision, maybe I should ask Representative Morgan to come up and talk about that provision, but they are allowed to ship those goods to other states where it's legal.
So, go ahead.
Hello, State Representative Bob Morgan. That's correct. The retailers that have some of these firearms or this ammunition, they will be allowed to sell to other states or to those. There are a number of provisions of continued sale, for instance, to active duty law enforcement, that retailers will be able to continue to sell.
Governor, what made
now the time that this passed? As you mentioned, this has been proposed before, it's come up short. What made the parts align this time?
Well, long ago was the time that we should have gotten this done. But as I've said for many months now, since the July 4th shooting in Highland Park, there is a very powerful lobby in the state of Illinois that has prevented passage of a bill like this. And it took a lot of strength and gumption and understanding and willingness to stand up to very powerful forces, for the people behind me who are in the legislature and their colleagues to finally get this done. And you know, it takes people who care deeply about keeping people safe from gun violence, who are in the General Assembly and who occupy the governor's office, together to get something like this passed. And then finally, we've seen too many mass shootings in such a very, very short period of time, and it's been happening for a long time, but I think now people are paying very close attention because it's not just, you know, the ones that happen in Highland Park and communities like that, but also we know that it's happening every week in the west side, south side of Chicago, and in communities that often are forgotten. And so I'm very proud of the legislature for the work that they did and all of us working together to get truly one of the best bills in the country passed.
Governor, would you say?
Representative Morgan, quick question for you. We spoke shortly after the Highland Park shooting, and you mentioned this would be a possibility down the road. Obviously, they came together months later. They were celebrating the anniversary right now of that shooting as well. What does this mean, not only for you, your family who's here tonight as well, and your community right now to have this signed as well?
As I spoke on the House floor yesterday, the six-month anniversary was a very, very difficult moment for my community, as there are those who are still recovering from not just the trauma, but their physical recovery of their wounds. And so this is incredibly important because our community was focused on making sure no other community experienced what we did. That really is the focus of Highland Park, and when we say Highland Park strong, what we mean is we don't want anyone else to go through what we did. And so it's very, very powerful and moving for us to know that we're going to take one step forward to reduce the likelihood that other communities will experience what we did.
Governor, the next time there's some tragedy in Illinois, or just the next weekend in Chicago, some folks might say they not only passed a constitutional bill, but it doesn't even work. I mean, I'm sure you know those news releases are coming and those arguments are coming on the floor.
Well, I think you heard me say a little bit earlier that there's no magic fix to the problem of gun violence, and it's something we're going to have to consistently work at. But I can guarantee you that the work that was done on this bill, the law that is now in place, will save lives. And it won't just be one life, it will be hundreds or potentially thousands of lives. And I'm grateful that people cared enough to get this done now, because going forward, we will see a reduction of gun violence as a result of this bill.
Governor, would you say this is the most meaningful piece of legislation you've ever signed? And also to Amanda's question, how do you get word out? How do you make sure that law-abiding citizens come into a compliance, that gun shops know what they need to do?
Well, I think I'll let Representative Morgan talk about the effort to talk to the gun dealers across the state and make sure that they're complying and also aware of what the law is. But you asked me whether it's the most meaningful piece of legislation. It's a hard question to answer. I can tell you that it means an awful lot to families all across the state, and that, you know, I can't compare it to the legislation that we passed to expand health care coverage for people, to make sure that people are able to get insulin who won't live if they aren't able to afford the insulin. It's hard to compare these things. What I can tell you is that the tragedies that people experience are felt by all of us who care deeply about the gun violence that's occurring across the state and reducing it in any way we can. This will save lives.
Governor, now that this is passed here,
What role do you think you have, if any, in talking about this on a national level as we try to, as some people try to get a national assault on these bad pastors?
Well, I've already begun that effort. In fact, I went with the mayor of Highland Park and the commander of the Highland Park Police to Washington for the signing of a bill to reduce gun violence, and this was back 4 or 5 months ago. And we sat down, just the four of us, the president of the United States, the mayor of Highland Park, the commander of the police there, and me, and we talked to the president directly about that. I've had countless conversations with members of our delegation, as well as the rest of members of Congress that I know, about getting something passed in Washington, D.C. I said it yesterday, I think, in my inaugural address, that even after we get this done here, which we just did, and become the ninth state, that we now need Washington, D.C., and the Congress to step up and get it done for the entire country.
With your conversations with the president about a national ban, do more states, do we need 10, 11, 12, in order for the federal government to move on something like this? Or can they move on it without any other additional states?
It shouldn't have to be that way, but you know, unfortunately, there are pro-NRA governors in at least half the states in the country. There are pro-NRA legislators in the House of Representatives, which is now in the hands of those pro-NRA legislators, and of course, almost half of the United States Senate. So. I don't know what it's going to take for them to move on it. What I know is that I'm going to do everything I can now and going forward to make sure that the Congress passes an assault weapons ban. It worked in the 90s. It worked. The statistics don't lie. So why won't they pass it now? It's because of the gun lobby. That's the reason. Well, we've shown that you can overcome the gun lobby. We've shown that here in Illinois. We can do that nationally, too.
You mentioned the work that went into it. You mentioned the work that went into ensuring that this law was constitutional. Just wondering how much of the Bruin decision went into that, given the change in the test for Second Amendment.
I'm going to bring Representative Morgan back because he really did lead this effort, and he himself is a practicing attorney, although I'm an attorney, I'll let him answer.
Feel as though I'm being set up. The constitutional interpretation of the Second Amendment, of course, loomed large over the drafting of this legislation. Both chambers took that very seriously. We have to make sure that we're passing laws that will withstand scrutiny. So we took those things into account, and of course, there were a lot of legal threats that came, and we look forward to being able to make our arguments in court.
You may be surprised to know I actually do talk about this all the time with people outside of the state of Illinois. But yes, of course, when I, for example, there's a National Governors Association meeting in February that I'll be at, I'll be talking to members. This is often a one-on-one kind of discussion. And yes, there are, you know, 535 members of Congress and 50 governors, but it is that personal connection with people and talking to them about what's possible in their states that they can get done that I think moves the ball. So I'll continue to do that. I think you know about me that I sort of never stop working. And I do think that on a national level, people ought to follow our lead.